One afternoon, while I was walking from Piraeus back towards Athens, I caught sight of the Epicurean Stoic. "Hey, you with a paradoxical name, could you wait for a moment?" I shouted. So he turned to me and waited. Once I was closer to him, I asked, "You are the Epicurean Stoic, right?" "Not a bad guess," he said. "Thank the gods for putting you in my path," I responded. "I want to hear all about that time when Socrates and the Sophists met outside Thrasymachus' house. I heard that you knew this story too, and that you're the most proper reporter of such affairs. So would you mind telling me what happened while our paths coincide?" "Of course I can," said the Epicurean Stoic. And this is how today's video begins. So first, a bit of context for the story. By the second half of the 5th century BC, Athens was the most prominent of all the Greek city-states. It played a key role in the fight against the Persian invaders, especially in the Battle of Salamis, and after that they kept increasing their naval power. The Aegean became their Mare Nostrum, if I may use the Roman term, and the falling trade boom brought with it a cultural one. Their new system of government, the democracy, also helped. The people were gathering in the assembly, the Ecclesia, where they would hear people speak on certain issues. They could of course speak too if they wanted, but in any case, at the end of the discussion, they were voting for or against the given motion. This climate made Athens the intellectual powerhouse that she's famous for. Wise men, the Sophists, were pouring in from lots of different areas to discuss and most importantly to teach the arts of rhetoric and politics. All this provided the perfect storm for the shift towards political philosophy and the much more important role society played within the new theories that sprung up. Anyway, back to the Epicurean Stoic, relaying the philosophical encounter. "I was walking back from the Agora," he said, "much like what we're doing today, and I saw them standing outside Thrasymachus' house. There was Socrates, arguing passionately as always, Plato, his most prominent student, and Hippias of Elis, the Sophist. Immediately I rushed towards them because I knew that the conversation would be interesting." "How can you say that, Hippias?" Socrates asked, and Hippias said, "But am I wrong in claiming that the laws of the polis are merely something that the citizens wrote down?" "Not at all, my friend, but they're not merely that." "Yes," said Plato, "they're about what the people of the polis agreed that they must and must not do." "Exactly, and that's integral to the unity of the city, its harmonious existence." "Yeah, I don't buy that really," said Hippias with a dismissive tone. "Think about it, my friends. How could I consider the laws as something worth taking seriously when the very people who establish them often don't extend such consideration towards them?" "How so?" Plato asked. "But they don't all agree on them, for starters. In your lovely city, there's at most a majority of the people who happen to be present at the Ecclesia. That's who agrees on the laws. What about those who voted against it, and all the others who weren't even present at the time? They didn't agree to them." Then Socrates said, "Don't waste your time trying to convince us, Hippias," before being interrupted by Plato. "Yeah, it's not like we think that democracy is some top-quality governing system. We're already with you on that one." "What are you doing?" Socrates said to Plato. "Why do you keep speaking over me?" As you know, Socrates never wrote anything before he died, and most of what we know of him comes to us from Plato. I'm sorry, Socrates," Plato said sheepishly. "I have to leave now, and I wanted to participate as much as possible in your conversation, I guess." "It's okay. I'll see you again next week, Socrates, right?" "Precisely, my dear." "Farewell, Plato," said Hippias. "Goodbye, my friends," was Plato's last words before he left. Not a moment later, Socrates turns back to Hippias. "Back to our point about democracy, Hippias." "Right," said he. "I'm not just talking about Athens. In every city, some people decide on the laws, but however small or great their number, they themselves reject the laws and change them so often, even the long-winged fly turns around less suddenly. Well, would we be correct in stating that different groups of people require different rules in order to coexist and cooperate?" asked Socrates. "No, we wouldn't. We're all humans, right?" "Yes." "Then why would we need different sets of rules from each other? Nature has ordained but one set of rules for us, yet all these different cities are pretending that theirs is the right one. These posited rules are silly conventions and they're not to be compared to the natural law." Hippias' point made even the great Socrates pause for a second. "You make a great point, my friend. So how would you have a polis function, if not for laws that it posits itself?" "I wouldn't. I'll have you know that all that I wear and carry I made myself. Self-sufficiency is what nature teaches us, and yet society rips it away as if it's a crime." "Oh, so out with society and cities altogether?" "Yes." "Then how would you be showing off your fine rhetoric skills and your handmade clothing and belongings?" "You're saying these things as if they're something to be ashamed of, Socrates. I don't know if you've heard, but this past summer, I made a habit of going to the Olympics and challenging anybody to come and spar with me, but instead of our fists, we would be throwing arguments at each other. Fascinating, said Socrates in his infamous sarcastic tone. Hippias exclaimed, and I have never been defeated, desperate for recognition. Well, you certainly haven't been defeated today either, my friend. I cannot think of anything to say against your fine words. Of course you can't, said Hippias, content. At that point, Gorgias approached them. Gorgias was a sophist too, but he had traveled from far away to end up in Athens. He hailed from Leontini in Sicily, and some say he was a student of Empedocles. Gorgias, said Socrates. Greetings, my friends. What brings you in this part of town, Gorgias? Asked Hippias, while Socrates said, yes, I thought you would be imparting some of your vast knowledge on the young of the city. I came to say a quick goodbye to Thrasymachus, actually. I haven't seen him in ages, and I'm leaving for Leontini tomorrow. And thank you for the sarcasm. Come on, I'm just teasing you. Before Gorgias had any chance to respond, Hippias said, stay where you are, Gorgias. I'll go fetch him for you. Thank you very much, my friend, said Gorgias. And off Hippias went to tell Thrasymachus about the new guest. As always, Socrates let no moment go by without continuing a discussion, which this time seemed to have taken place ages prior. So, up for another discussion with an old friend? Why not? It's not like anything matters. Cheeky. Now, where had we left off last time? Ah yeah, you going completely against the great Parmenides of Elea and his students and saying that nothing exists. By Helen, your memory never fails you, Socrates. You're absolutely right, that's what I said. But you're only half joking, right? Asked Socrates. I mean, okay, I get it. You disagree with Parmenides as one being, and you think that with your great skills in rhetoric, you can create an argument saying that nothing exists just as easily as he created his argument for the existence of being. But there's more to it than that, I guess. Yes, I think I could be wrong about that. Oh, how refreshingly humble of you. But even if something exists, we would never be able to know about it. But why? Said Socrates. You of all people, so full of knowledge, why would you say this? Because if something exists, it's nothing like the earthly objects we have in mind. Unless you think that all these trees and the chairs and the dogs are real. Well, not really, but I'm not the one saying that nothing exists. So even if the real existing things are not like the stuff we see around us, what kind of things are they? I couldn't possibly tell you, my friend. They're precisely the kind of things that we can't know anything about. I guess that adds up, murmured Socrates. And even if something exists, and we manage to gain knowledge about it, we wouldn't be able to communicate that knowledge to other people. Of course, I've heard somewhere that you've gone mad. Why do you dismiss the power of language, Gorgias? Don't we discuss all the time? Yeah, but we can't transmit knowledge by words, mere sounds we make with our mouths, gestures with our hands. Hey, don't forget the written symbols. How ironic. Yes, I know. What do you mean you know? I thought your whole shtick was that the only thing you know is that you know nothing. It's a figure of speech, Gorgias. Get with the times. See just how easy it is to confuse what people mean, though. Language is not as powerful as you think. I couldn't disagree more on this, and I find it shocking that you say these things. Why? Well, if you actually believed all this, then you wouldn't develop such amazing skills in oratory and persuading people with your eloquent speeches. And even if you had practiced endlessly towards this end, you wouldn't be able to persuade anyone, since language is so useless, as you say. At the sound of this, Gorgias stayed silent. Socrates, of course, took it as an invitation to go on. And even if you convinced anybody, you wouldn't manage to truly change them, as you wouldn't be able to impart any knowledge on them, as you said. That's right. Then why are you teaching? And most importantly, why are you charging so much money for your lessons? There must be something for them to learn. Nothing about what matters, about what exists. Ah, I see. So rhetoric, politics, debates, and defense speeches in courts, all this is tried to you. Pretty much. And the reason being? We've come full circle, my friend, because nothing exists. Nice, said Socrates, and he started laughing. Why the sudden laughter, great Socrates? People say that after a conversation with me, they are left with aporia, a state of uncertainty and being at a loss, having realized just how little they know. And yet here I am in exactly that state after such a brief discussion with you. You get over it, don't worry. A man can only hope. It is after Socrates said this that Hippias and Thrasymachus came out of the house. Hippias quickly said, I have to apologize to everyone, but I'll leave you three now. Socrates responded with, that's okay, Hippias, see you soon, while Gorgias said his goodbye too, and Hippias left them. Gorgias turned to Thrasymachus. How are you, Thrasymachus? I'm very well, thank you, my friend. What a great honor to have both Socrates and Gorgias standing outside my house. Easy with the compliments, dear, or Alcibiades might get jealous, said Socrates, and the three men laughed. Alcibiades was a young Athenian politician at the time, infatuated with Socrates. A very interesting historical figure for sure, but here we'll stay on Socrates and the Sophists. Gorgias then said, "First of all, it's good to see you, Thrasymachus. I came to say goodbye. Have a safe trip back, my friend, and I'll see you soon. Wait, I also came to bring you some news that you will appreciate, especially now. Don't keep me waiting, away from the joy that will bring me. What happened?" Gorgias then gave him the news. "Protagoras himself is on his way. He'll be here in a minute." Thrasymachus was elated. "By the gods, this is amazing. I haven't had interesting conversations in a while, so I guess that will make up for that." "Certainly," said Socrates, and sure enough, Protagoras was approaching them. "There he is. Gorgias was just letting us know you're coming, great Protagoras." "Greetings, my good friends. How are you this nice afternoon?" said Protagoras. "We're all fine," Gorgias answered. "Never better, Protagoras," said Socrates. "What quirky discussions did you three have before I interrupted you?" "I just came outside, actually. And we were talking about the worryingly nihilistic views of Gorgias." "Amazing. Alright, I have to go now. The ship leaves early tomorrow morning and I have a couple of last errands to run here." "Farewell, Gorgias," said Protagoras, while Socrates said, "So long. We will resume our conversation when we meet again. Let's hope I have answers to give you by then." "Always a pleasure seeing you, Gorgias, even for a fleeting moment." After Thrasymachus said this, Gorgias went on his way. Socrates then said, "Okay then, it's me against the relativists." "That's not like you, Socrates," Protagoras scolded him, "making such amateurish mistakes." "Oh no, what did I say? Thrasymachus here doesn't agree with me that man is the measure of all things, do you, my friend?" "I'm afraid not, Socrates." "But I thought you were saying that there is no objective morality," said Socrates, apologetically. "Well, kind of, but I never said that everybody's view is the same. I just think that what's just is whatever is in the interest of the strongest man, the most powerful." "Very interesting. So justice, as we typically think of it, do you consider that a vice?" "No, merely a noble simple-mindedness." "And do you consider injustice a flaw, a wickedness?" "Again, as we typically think of it." "The opposite, that's good judgment." "So the unjust person is the wisest to you?" "Yes, but not just a mere petty thief. I'm talking about the most powerful people. The ones who are able to be perfectly unjust yet appear perfectly just. And in doing so, they subject whole cities and races of men to their will." "What do you think about this, Protagoras?" Protagoras said, "You're making me repeat myself here, Socrates. I've said that man is the measure of all things. For those that are, that they are, and for those that are not, that they are not. And I mean each man. What is just and right and good for me is just and right and good. What is just and right and good for Thrasymachus, or his favorite tyrants, is just and right and good, you know, for them." "At least you're consistently subversive, Protagoras," joked Socrates. "Look who's talking," said Thrasymachus. Socrates didn't like the sound of that. "Why would you say that? I follow the great Parmenides in his belief of perfect and unchanging beings, while you and Protagoras follow the Heraclitean doctrine of ever-present flux." "I suppose you're right," considered Protagoras. "So things just are the way they appear to me, right?" Socrates continued. "Yes. And nothing is stable, since the wind can be called for you and not called for me, which is to say that there are no intrinsic qualities whatsoever, only the ones we attach to things in relation to other things, mainly ourselves." "Exactly," said Protagoras. "So for you, there is no objectivity whatsoever, no universal standard of beauty or wisdom, let's say." "There isn't, no." "But my dear friend, can you not see how wrong you are on this? If there is no such standard, then how can we say that your speeches are always measured and beautiful, and that you're undeniably among the wisest men in the world? If what you believe or argue for is not much better than any random bloke's opinions, why do students gather around you and pay fortunes their fathers don't have to be taught by the great Protagoras?" "Very perceptive, Socrates. I guess one could say that I'm like the doctor who might provide a drug to a patient that alters their taste and have more pleasant things appear with it, for example a sweeter wine rather than a sour one. My speeches can touch people's souls, but what they cannot do is make them change their false opinions to true ones. No such things exist. Instead, I can change people's souls so that they perceive things in a more useful way, a way they like more." "So you're just giving them what they like, not what they need?" Thrasymachus was puzzled. "Where's the difference?" he asked. "Nice," Socrates laughed. "But what about all the people who disagree with you, Protagoras? To them, it appears that opinions can be correct or mistaken, so to them, that is the case. And also, opining and perceiving are not the same thing, surely." "Well, I'd love to stay and listen to the answer, but I'm afraid I have to go inside, it's getting late," said Thrasymachus at that point. "You're right, Thrasymachus. If we continue, the saffron-veiled dawn will find us in the same spot like planted trees," Protagoras said in haste. Socrates caught notice of this and teased him. "You're saying this as if it's a bad thing." Protagoras then said, "As always, a pleasure talking to you both." To which Thrasymachus answered, "The pleasure is all ours, Protagoras. It was an honor." Finally, Socrates exclaimed, "Have a good night, my friends." And they all walked in different directions. So as you can see, this is what Socrates and the Sophists thought and said to each other, if my memory serves me right. They each claimed to be ideological heirs of Parmenides or Heraclitus, and yet they only took parts of each philosopher's views, while either ignoring or misinterpreting others. Thank you so much, Epicurean Stoic. I hope I find you again soon, I said. Next week, probably. Alright then, may the gods extend only their graceful hand your way, my friend. Talk soon. Farewell. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you liked the format I chose for this one. I figured that since our biggest source on these philosophers and these issues, Plato only wrote dialogues, I might as well do the same. If you enjoyed it, press like and subscribe to my channel, help it grow. I'll see you in the next one, which will be about the ethical theories of Socrates/Plato, and yes, it will also be in the form of a dialogue, so get hyped. Until then, have a great day, live up to Socrates' maxim that the unexamined life is not worth living, and as a result, and as always, seek virtue.